Good evening. I want to take a moment and thank you. Each one of you believe that each speaker here has ideas worth sharing. So on the speakers and myself, I thank each one of you for coming today. You have done your job. You have encouraged us. We feel proud. You've done what you were supposed to do. That's the end of the night. Thank you, people. Thank you very much. On a serious note, we talk about innovation, imagination, inspiring. And how do you do this in your everyday life? What do you do to fulfill this? So let's just take a second and let's just look at each person. They say, to live without purpose is not to live. So what is our purpose? How many of you have children or know people that have children? You can raise your hands, that's fine. Why did you have children? Did you have children because it happened? Or did you have children because you want to give to the future? I want to be a part of the future. I want my legacy carried on. Great. That's fantastic. We want our legacy. So what do? We get pregnant, and let me tell you, we eat the proper foods, we take our vitamins, we put those earphones on our belly so that our child's going to be the next Einstein. He's going to be intelligent. Yes, he's got to listen to classical music. And then the baby's born. And then we recite the ABCs and the 1, 2, 3s. You know what? My Muhammad can count from 1 to 100 and all the way back to 1. And he is 3. And then there's Sally. Sally is reading chapter books, and she is just turning 6. How about other conversations? How about Adli? He's in his room for 1 hour, playing with Legos. And ding dong, the doorbell rings. That's his friend coming over. He's so excited. He gets out and leaves that room. Mom walks in, and what does she see? Adli! How many times have I told you? Sort out these Legos. Put them in colors. I've bought you boxes. Keep them on the table. Keep them organized. Why do you have to dump out the Legos like this? Okay, sorry, Mom. Shema comes running up to Mom and says, Mom sees the paint on her brand new shirt, on the wall, on the floor. Shema, what are you doing? How many times have I told you? Paint on the canvas, not on the walls, not on your hands. And Shema goes, but Mommy, please, please, just take a picture. Take a picture. Mom takes a picture. Shema goes up and cleans it all. You have to go to this ball. You've picked out your dress, beautiful red dress. You iron it, you lay it out on the bed, and you get into the shower and you're getting ready. And there's Jackson. Whew, a red dress with straps? Awesome! Takes the dress, puts it around his neck, and dashes down that corridor as fast as he can. He's running, he's decking it. Oh. What is that mom gonna say? She sees that dress, grabbing all the dust on the floor. Oh, she can't even wear it. And then there's the mom who spent all day cleaning. She's cleaned the house, she's done everything. She's so proud of herself, it's perfect. And she notices the kitchen door is closed. What? Kitchen door is closed? Who's in there? Opens the door. Kayla! What is this? I just clean this. She sees fruit slices everywhere. The knife, the cutting board, it's all over. It's everywhere. Clean up the kitchen now. The mother goes into Adli's room, picks up all those Lego because his friends is over, so she has to do it. And she notices as she picks up all this, she's throwing them, she's really upset. She sees a heart. She's a heart made of Lego pieces. Shema's mom is exhausted and she's lying down in bed and going through her photos. The photos she took of Shema's hands. And she noticed Shema's canvas was her hands. It was not the canvas, it was her hands. Kayla's mom, whenever she wakes up in the morning, she loves her water, and she must have lemon in it. So Kayla goes, oh, mom, I'll get you water this morning. And she notices, she gets her water, and she's looking at the glass. The mom is looking at the glass. Are those small lemon pieces? What is that? And she notices those are small lemon pieces infused into ice cubes. It was the best water her mom had ever tried. When Jackson's mom went to his room, do you remember the red dress, the cape? Do you remember? She saw papers on his desk, and those papers had notes about mom's blue dress, mom's gold dress. And she's thinking, what is he talking about? So she goes to read further. Depending on the length of the dress is how fast Jackson had to calculate how fast he needed to run down that corridor. So were those acts of disobedience? Or were those acts of innovation? Those were innovative minds at work. But we talked about, the first thing we thought is those kids, they don't follow the rules. Human nature is naturally diverse. Naturally. We crave variety. You guys came here today. You were asked questions, right? And the reason is because we wanted various people from different parts of the world, from different trains of thoughts of mind. We love diversity. How many of you have more than one kid? When you bring up more than one kid, do you feed them the same food, put on the same shirt? It's the same thing every single day. Do we bring our children up, or are they each a different child? So we talk about this. Let's look at the job market. I mean, you want your kids to eventually grow up and get a great job. Let's take a look at companies and what they are looking for. Apple talks about innovation. GE, imagination. Techlution talks about having innovative employees. These companies want employers that have these novel ideas to come up with the next new best toy, the next best tool. So parents celebrate diversity. Jobs want the diversity. And they want the innovation. Great. What does creativity stem from? Creativity stems from curiosity, asking questions. So there's a Newsweek study, and that study showed that the average preschool student asks 100 questions a day, 100 questions. The average middle school student, ages 11 to 14, asks zero. Why? Why are our kids not asking questions? Why do we ask questions? We ask questions because we want to know something. You are here today because you want to know on a certain subject matter, maybe two. Yet our schools are saying, put the brake on it. Do not ask those questions. Or have our students lost interest? What is happening? Now, let's take a look at schools. Schools are where your kids, at least until the age of 18, spend most of their waking hours. This is a classroom. This classroom has not changed for 80 years. The last 80 years, we are still sitting in rows. We are still taking the same tests, the same books, and we are expected to behave the exact same way in the classroom. Yet at home, we have different children, different personalities. Companies are looking for different types of employees. So why in school are we expecting them to all be the same? So we come up with something. We come up with these desks, stools. We have innovation. We're gonna sit in groups today, guys. Really? So all of you that are extremely intelligent in science are gonna sit in this group. And all of you that love to write are gonna sit in this group. Similar group. There's a school in Eanes District. First, when you see here, you saw all these students sitting in desks. The teacher gets up there, and you're thinking, this is a school that's supposed to be the hub of innovation. But guess what, guys? These desks and these chairs had wheels on them. Can you imagine? I would love, you're gonna teach a kid and they're sitting in a wheelchair. What happens when you're sitting with a kid that's in a wheelchair? What happens? He's going back and forth, turning. Oh yeah, I can spin this chair. Teachers were not ready to accept it. But when you gave the ownership to those students to take over of their learning, to learn in the environment that they felt most comfortable, where they can learn, they raised up the bar. They taught us how they wanted. This is called what we call Socratic circles, okay? This is where, these are Socratic, where they talk about a piece of literature. This group actually teaches and puts things on the computer, and then these view what they're doing. But we cringe at the thought of change. We cringe about wheels on a desk, on a chair, and we're going to sit and do that. How? We reward students in schools for knowing the answer. But how many of us reward students for asking the right questions? I am going to ask you today to take a look at your environments. Whether it's school, whether it's your job, whether it's your home, what does it scream? Does it scream conform? Or does it scream diverse? Disruptive. That is what I want to see. Disruptive thinking. We are here at TED. Do you know what TED celebrates? TED celebrates the gift of the human imagination. Get that, the gift of the human imagination. Each one of us in here, at home, in the world, are innately creative. And let me repeat what I just said, innately creative. Creative is not art. Creative is not just acting. Creative is not just drama. The person who invented post-it notes is innovative. The person who came up with the injection for measles is innovative. The person who came up with the innovative way of thinking how to discipline your kids by noticing the infused ice cubes. Take a second to look what is happening. What is that action? What is that environment screaming? And harvest an innovative learner. Thank you very much.